bad.
I was looking at the one in your hand.
You got my face. Yes. Soothing presence.
He's a really good Igor.
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 You know what, or you want to run through it?
I know.
So, is that okay on the regular key, or do I have to key and hold it?
It's always nice to drop it, but if you want to leave it,
I'll make the executive decision.
Drop it, but when I give Dave the key, he and I always serve him.
2 minutes.
Yeah, it'll. If I have to start from every good shot, you get you like this. Like, I'm surprised. You play all the same.
Liz gets to approve it.
Just give me the starting.
I think it's. Well, the starting point is like this.
Picks people up sitting next to there pretty well too, because we got Brent, you could really hear him.
Yeah, I heard what he was doing that.
Yeah.
But you couldn't hear the pastor.
I'll move over.
No, I'm just saying.
Yep. I was trying to figure out.
Fair warning, you will hear your voice. It does pick it up.
Now, good morning and welcome to our radio broadcast to First English Lutheran Church this morning. A tape of this service will be placed on our website following worship. Special thanks to our group helping us in worship this morning, Kevin, Jim, Christy, Kelsey, Darren. Liz is our lector, Marilyn our organist, Terry's back there making sure I look good, and Dan Verdan, who also, by the way, it's his birthday today, so everybody wave happy birthday. So our broadcast this morning is sponsored by your gifts to the Endowment Fund. We will continue to have no public activities at First English through the end of March, and this includes all organizations that meet here. Decisions regarding April will be made later on this week, probably by the end of the week. We will also carry our Wednesday evening 5:30 midweek service on Facebook Live if all permits. We continue to have some blizzard boxes available if you or anyone you know is in need of some food items. We also have people available to deliver groceries to you if you need them, so please don't feel guilty about calling 839-2527. And during these challenging times, please remember your pledges and tithes so we can continue to support our staff. They may be dropped off or mailed. The office continues to be open, and we ask that you do all you can in any way you can to support our Main Street businesses during this time of being closed. Are there any other announcements this morning? There's no one to give them, so I guess we're good to go. All right, and I also would say on our website, when the bulletin's on there, you'll see some Prairie 5 meal emergency preparedness and community action announcements. So if that will help you in any way, please make use of that. We begin our worship in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. And our confession can be found on page 117 in the front of the hymnal. We confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. We continue with our first hymn, Faith of Our Fathers, hymn number 812. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We continue with our Kyrie. Hymn of praise, hymn number 824, This Is My Father's World.
Trees of skies and seas, His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world, the birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily bright, declare their Maker's praise. This is my Father's world, it shines in all that's fair, in the rustling grass I hear Him pass. Speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me not forget that though the wrong seems oft so strong, God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. Why should my heart be sad? The Lord is King, let the heavens ring, and reigns, let earth be glad.
And we join together in the prayer of the day.
Bend your ears to hear prayers, Lord Christ, and come among us. By your gracious life and death for us, bring light into the darkness of our hearts and anoint us with your Spirit. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The reading can be found on page 202 of the Old Testament in the Pew Bibles. Samuel anointed David even though he was the eighth oldest son of Jesse and did not match his brothers in height or other physical characteristics. With the anointing came endowment with the Spirit of the Lord, designating David as the Lord's chosen successor to Saul. A reading from 1 Samuel, the 16th chapter, beginning with the first verse. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse, the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what to do, and you shall anoint for me the one whom I name to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him, trembling, and said, "Do you come peaceably?" He said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourself and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked at Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed is now before the Lord." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. He said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by, and he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel, and Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all of your sons here?" And he said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." He sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. The Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah. The word of the Lord. Psalm 23 is found in the red ELW hymnal between the readings and the hymns. We will read responsively by half verse. A reading from the 23rd Psalms, beginning with verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd.
I shall not be in want.
The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures.
And leads me beside still waters.
You restore my soul, O Lord.
And guide me along.
Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil.
For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies.
You anoint my head with oil, and my cup is running over.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The reading can be found on page 150 of the New Testament in the Pew Bibles. Because we now live in the divine light that is Jesus Christ, we conduct our lives in ways that reflect the light of Christ, so that our activity is truly pleasing to God. A reading from Ephesians, the 5th chapter, beginning with the 8th verse. For once you were darkness, but now in the Lord you are light. Live as children of light, for the fruit of light is found in all that is good and right and true. Try to find out what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to mention what such people do secretly. But everything exposed by the light becomes visible. For everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will be hearing the gospel lesson again shortly. Thanks to our worship assistants who will so ably give us the dramatic presentation of it. But I'd also like to read it this morning from the Children's Bible. And it's the story of Jesus healing a man born blind. Jesus and his disciples saw a blind beggar. He had been blind since he was born. The disciples asked Jesus, "Teacher, did this man sin or did his parents? Is that why he's blind?" "No one sinned," said Jesus. "This happened so that God's work could be shown in his life." Then Jesus spit on the ground and made mud out of it with his hands. He gently spread the mud on the blind man's eyes. Then Jesus told a man, "Go to the pool of Siloam and wash off the mud." As soon as the mud was washed off, the man could see. Everyone was amazed, and they wanted to find out more about Jesus. So in our gospel today, a man who had been born blind, he had been blind since the day he was born, gets to see for the first time. And before Jesus healed him, he could only see through his hands, through his fingertips, through his ears, through his nose. He could only see by touch, smell, and taste. It's hard for me to understand what it must be like to see something for the very first time. I tried to get a small taste of that by keeping my eyes closed for several minutes, and then when I opened my eyes, I saw things differently. I hadn't noticed some of the sounds that were around me until all I could do was hear those sounds. And things looked brighter, and I noticed things that I normally might not: cars going by, people talking, birds singing. So today, as you hear the story of Jesus giving sight to a man who had been blind from birth, close your eyes. Don't fall asleep, but close your eyes and listen to the different voices. Try to feel that mud on your eyes and the cool water washing the mud away. Listen to the neighbors and the Pharisees gossip and question that man. Try to feel what the man must have felt, his happiness, his joy. And try to hear the good news that Jesus loves and cares for each of us, especially those who are sick or care for the sick. So close your eyes then and pray for all who are in danger at this time. Amen. We continue with our next hymn, What Wondrous Love Is This? Present the Holy Gospel from the Message, and we thank Christy, Kelsey, Darren, and Kevin for sharing with us this morning.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. The Holy Gospel according to John, the 9th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Walking down the street, Jesus saw a blind man, blind from birth. His disciples asked,
Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, causing him to be born blind?
Jesus said,
You are asking the wrong question. You are looking for someone to blame. There is no such cause-effect here. Look instead for what God can do. We need to be energetically at work for the one who sent me here, working while the sun shines. When night falls, the workday is over. For as long as I am in the world, there is plenty of light. I am the world's light.
He said this, and then he spit in the dust, made a clay paste with the saliva, rubbed the paste on the blind man's eyes, and said,
Go, wash at the pool of Siloam.
Siloam means sent. The man went and washed and saw. Soon the town was buzzing. His relatives and those who year after year had seen him as a blind man begging were saying,
Why, isn't this the man we knew, who sat here and begged?
Others said,
It's him, all right.
But others objected,
It's not the same man at all. It just looks like him.
He said,
It's me, the very one.
They said,
how did your eyes get opened?
A man named Jesus made a paste and rubbed it in my eyes and told me, go to Siloam and wash. I did what he said. When I washed, I saw.
So where is he?
I don't know.
They marched the man to the Pharisees. This day when Jesus made the paste and healed his blindness was the Sabbath. The Pharisees grilled him again on how he had come to see. He said,
he put a clay paste on my eyes, and I washed, and now I see.
Some of the Pharisees said,
obviously, this man can't be from God. He doesn't keep the Sabbath.
Others countered,
how can a bad man do miraculous God-revealing things like this?
There was a split in their ranks. They came back at the blind man.
You're the expert. He opened your eyes. What do you say about him?
He said,
he is a prophet.
The Jews didn't believe it. Didn't believe the man was blind to begin with. So they called the parents of the man, now bright-eyed with sight. They asked them,
is this your son, the one you say was born blind? So how is it that he now sees?
His parents said,
we know he is our son, and we know he was born blind. But we don't know how he came to see, having a clue about who opened his eyes. Why don't you ask him? He's a grown man and can speak for himself.
His parents were talking like this because they were intimidated by the Jewish leaders who had already decided that anyone who took a stand that he was the Messiah would be kicked out of the meeting place. That's why his parents said, ask him. He's a grown man. They called the man back a second time. The man who had been blind told him,
give credit to God. We know this man is an imposter.
He replied,
I know nothing about that one way or the other, but I know one thing is for sure. I was blind, I now see.
They said,
what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?
I have told you over and over, and you haven't listened. Why do you want to hear it again? Are you so eager to become his disciples?
With that, they jumped all over him.
You might be a disciple of that man, but we're disciples of Moses. We know for sure that God spoke to Moses, but we have no idea where this man even comes from.
The man replied,
this is amazing. You claim to know nothing about him, but the fact is, he opened my eyes. It's well known that God isn't at the beck and call of sinners, but listens carefully to anyone who lives in reverence and does his will. That someone opened the eyes of a man born blind has never been heard of, ever. If this man didn't come from God, he wouldn't be able to do anything.
They said,
you're nothing but dirt. How dare you take that tone with us?
Then they threw him out in the street. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out. He went and found him. He asked him,
do you believe in the Son of Man?
The man said,
point him out to me, sir, so that I can believe in him.
Jesus said,
you're looking right at him. Don't you recognize my voice?
Master, I believe.
The man said, and worshipped him. Jesus then said,
I came into the world to bring everything into the clear light of day, making all the distinctions clear, so that those who have never seen will see, and those who have made a great pretense of seeing will be exposed as blind.
Some Pharisees overheard him and said,
does that mean you're calling us blind?
Jesus said,
if you were really blind, you would be blameless. But since you claim to see everything so well, you are accountable for every fault and failure.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
So as we just heard, and you guys may sit if you would like, a man who was born blind is given the gift of sight by Jesus. You'd think there would be a major celebration, wouldn't you? Blind from birth and now for the first time can see. As we'll sing in our closing hymn, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was blind, but now I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. But for the people of the day, for the neighbors and for the Pharisees, there is no party. First, the neighbors doubt that it's really the man. It's just someone who looks like him. And then the Pharisees get involved. First, they're unhappy because someone worked on the Sabbath day. Yes, to them, healing is work, and on the Sabbath, it's a sin. We can thank God that that rule has changed in our day and age. The people were blind, much like we are at times, to what is really important in life. They're more concerned with who or what gave Jesus the authority to do this. Blindness was considered at the time to be a punishment for sin. And blindness from birth must be the parents' fault, their sin, and the child was being punished for their sin. So they interrogate the blind man. Who did it? How did this happen? Can you empathize with that poor blind man? He can see for the first time in his life, he can really see. And instead of celebrating, they kick him out of the community when he asks them if they want to become disciples of Jesus too. So the blind man is given the gift of sight, but no one will rejoice with him. And when Jesus heard they kicked him out, Jesus went and offered consolation, clarity, and empathy. The healed man is grateful and wants a better understanding of that one who healed him. And with that, he confesses his belief and worships Jesus. And that is one of the lessons in this story for us today. We should rejoice with others when they receive good news. And we should console others when they receive not such good news. Especially during times like we're in right now. We are in a time of the unknown. But there's one thing we do know, and that is God is with us. And we can live with hope. We can live with kindness. We can share our blessings, and we can take care of each other. Because we are all made whole by God's amazing grace. And we can always pray that the Lord would make us instruments of peace. And where there is sadness, we can sow joy. And grant that we may seek not so much to be consoled as to console. Amen. We'll continue with our next hymn, number 733, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Side.
Please be seated. And we will confess our faith with the whole church in the words of the Apostles' Creed, as is found on page 217. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you traveled through towns and villages, curing every disease and illness. At your command, the sick were made well, the blind were made to see. Come to our aid now in the midst of the global spread of the coronavirus, that we may experience your healing love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heal those who are sick. May they regain their strength and health through quality medical care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heal us from our fear, which prevents nations from working together and prevents neighbors from helping each other. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heal us from our pride, which can make us claim invulnerability to a disease that knows no borders. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Jesus, you are healer of all. Stay by our side in this time of uncertainty. Be with those who have died. May they be at rest with you in eternal peace. Lord, in your mercy, be with the families of those who are sick. As they worry and grieve, defend them from illness and despair. May they know your peace. Lord, in your mercy, be with the doctors, the nurses, the researchers, and all medical professionals who seek to heal and help those affected and who put themselves at risk in the process. May they know your protection and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, be with the leaders of all nations. Give them the foresight to act with charity and true concern for the well-being of the people they are meant to serve. Give them the wisdom to invest in long-term solutions that will help prepare for or prevent future outbreaks. May they know your peace and your guidance as they work together to achieve it here on earth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless and strengthen all who are alone or lonely at this time, especially the people in Fairway View, the catered living, independent living in the neighborhoods. Bless them with comfort, and we ask that you bless the workers who care for them and give them company. Bless and strengthen our local businesses, especially the restaurants, who are all hit hard economically during this time. Help us to share and support those who need our help. Lord, in your mercy. Whether we are home or abroad, whether we are surrounded by many people suffering from this illness or only a few or none at all, Jesus, stay with us as we endure and mourn, as we persist and prepare. In place of our anxiety, give us your peace. In Jesus Christ's name, please heal us. We join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon each of you with kindness and with favor and give you true peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And our closing hymn, Amazing Grace, number 779.